Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us for Coast Day. My name is Chris Hauser. I'm the Associate Director of Delaware Sea Grant. This session is cleaning up ghost pots in the inland bays, which will summarize the findings of a Delaware Sea Grant funded pilot scale research project. This session is in the investigation track, which is brought to you by the Delaware Municipal Electric Corporation. Our speakers today are Dr. Art Trembanis and Kate Fleming. Dr. Trembanis is a professor of oceanography at the University of Delaware, where he develops and utilizes advanced autonomous systems to map and explore oceans and lakes around the world. His passion for exploration has led to discoveries ranging from ancient shipwrecks to modern aircraft and unraveling environmental mysteries along the way. Kate Fleming is Delaware Sea Grant's coastal ecologist with a background rooted in protected and living resources. She especially enjoys working on projects that provide coastal stewardship opportunities for Delawareans across our state. Before we begin, I want to remind the audience that you can submit questions at any point for the presenters using the Q&A app at the bottom of your Zoom screen. We'll address as many of these questions as we can at the end of the session. Art and Kate, with that, I'll turn it over to you. Please take us away.
So we're going to start out with a poll question for everyone. Okay. Just want to get to know our audience a little bit. Do you like to eat blue crabs? Have you ever potted for blue crabs? And have you ever come across a lost or abandoned crab pot? Are we ready to show results? All right, we got a lot of people who like blue crabs. Okay, we've got some folks here that have been crabbing before with crab pots and some folks that have come across lost and abandoned pots. That's good. All right, it's good to get to know our audience before we get started. As Chris said, I'm Kate Fleming. I'm Delaware Sea Grant's Coastal Ecology Specialist, and I'm joined here today by my colleague, Dr. Art Trembanis, who will be speaking in just a little bit. We're going to be talking to you about our work hunting for ghosts in Delaware's inland bays. And if you haven't figured out, the ghosts we're referring to has to do with these guys, the blue crab fishery. So Delaware's blue crab fishery is our biggest in the state. It's our most lucrative fishery, bringing in about $7 million on an annual basis. And our recreational fishery leads to the capture of over 1 million blue crabs each year as well. Oftentimes using this gear we were talking about in that first poll, these Chesapeake style, commercial style crab pots as they're often referred to. And so the ghosts we're talking about are when those crab pots become lost or abandoned in the environment. They can continue to function properly. When they're not under the control of the crabber that set them, the animals that are attracted to that pot can get stuck inside and unable to escape. So it can lead to a lot of needless mortality, which can have both economic and ecological consequences. So I want to describe in a little bit more detail about what the ghost fishing looks like inside a crab pot. So to do that, I just want to make sure we actually had a lot of people in the beginning say they'd never been potting for blue crabs before. So hopefully this will familiarize you with how it works. So this is again the Chesapeake style or commercial style crab pot, as they're oftentimes referred to. It's frequently used in a recreational blue crab fishery, not to be confused with these crab traps that have these collapsible sides when they're set on the bottom of the seafloor. But so these crab pots, they have a lower chamber oftentimes and an upper chamber that's separated by this divider, and then a bait container in that lower portion of the chamber. And that will attract blue crabs to come inside after that bait through one of these funnel entrances. Most of these pots will have maybe four funnel entrances. This diagram is only showing one. So one thing I want to point out is the cull ring here. So this is a feature that's actually not required to be installed on crab pots here in Delaware. However, they're required in many of our neighboring states, and they've been demonstrated to show that they reduce the mortality associated with the crabbing activity by allowing smaller organisms to escape. So sublegal crabs, crabs that wouldn't be large enough to be legally kept anyways, as well as other juvenile animals. So that's something that you can purchase and install regardless of whether or not it's required. I also want to mention that the marker buoy in Delaware here in the recreational blue crab fishery is required to be an all white buoy that you fill out with your name and address. And then one feature that isn't on this pot that I want to point out is the bycatch reduction device, which I've represented here by this orange triangle. These are required to be installed on all funnel entrances of these crab pots to help minimize the potential for these guys, these diamondback terrapins. There are only brackish water turtle in the United States. It helps minimize the potential for them to get inside the pots. They're oftentimes attracted to the same bait that blue crabs are attracted to. And so what happens when a pot is lost or abandoned, and I would say this pot's been lost because you can see its line has been severed from its marker buoy, so it's beneath the surface of the water, unable to be relocated by a crabber. So what happens is, it's interesting in that a blue crab, when it enters into that lower chamber, it can actually escape fairly easily. Blue crabs that stay in the lower chamber have about an 85% escapement rate. Whereas once they swim upwards, which they often do, their escapement rates decrease to about 1 to 4%. And that's when they'll end up dying due to a number of mechanisms such as starvation or cannibalism. Blue crabs eat each other, or an inability to get away from diseased animals or poor water quality. And then I'll just point out that this crab pot is missing its bycatch reduction device, also referred to as a terrapin excluder device or a turtle bycatch reduction device. It's got a few different names. And so this is what we worry about. We worry about these diamondback terrapins getting inside, and then they need to surface in order to be able to breathe. So they tend to die by drowning when they get stuck inside these pots. So it turns out that where we have blue crab fisheries, we tend to see a certain amount of loss and abandonment. It's very common. To kind of demonstrate that, I have this figure up on the screen here that shows the estimated number of derelict crab pots throughout the Chesapeake, which is one of our largest blue crab fisheries in the United States. And so what we tend to see is in these states that have blue crab fisheries on the Atlantic coast and the Gulf of Mexico, we oftentimes see associated recovery programs to help remove them from the environment with the recognition that they do come with these economic and ecological impacts. So as an example, the state of North Carolina has recovered 35,000 derelict crab pots since 2003. And a Gulf of Mexico example, the state of Louisiana has recovered 37,000 since 2004. So here in Delaware, the Delaware Coastal Program several years ago ran some side scan sonar surveys to look for derelict crab pots lost beneath the surface of the water, and found about 500 or so in this area up where the Delaware Bay kind of intersects with the Delaware River. We have both commercial and recreational blue crabbing in that area. And that kind of served as a launching point for Art and I to start exploring whether or not we didn't also have derelict crab pots in our inland bays, which is a really neat environment to be looking and trying to understand this question. For a number of reasons, one being that we have nearly exclusively recreational crabbing here, except for this one small area adjacent to Maryland's waters. It's all recreational crabbing in our inland bays. And so being able to understand pot loss and abandonment here offers an opportunity to understand how the recreational crabbing industry is contributing to this issue. And also kind of, I think, highlights and builds some opportunity, opens some opportunity to maybe leverage the recreational user group to help contribute to the solution. So kind of with this question in mind of wanting to better understand if this is an issue in our inland bays, in February of 2019, Art and I, using program development funds from Delaware Sea Grant, initiated some initial exploratory surveys just to look for these derelict crab pots to find out and confirm if we have an issue in our inland bays. And what we found is, yeah, we do. We found in about 100 acres surveyed throughout portions of Rehoboth Bay, we found 1.6 pots per acre through those exploratory surveys. And so I'm going to hand it over to Art now to talk about how we look for these crab pots when they're beneath the surface of the water.
Great. Thank you, Kate. And hello, everyone. Welcome to today's session. I'm really excited to be able to talk to you about this project. This has been a really fun and challenging partnership between Delaware Sea Grant and Kate and myself and my group and a number of other partners that we'll list it at the end. It really has taken a big village to get to work on this. And as Chris mentioned at the beginning, I guess the easiest way to describe the work I do is I use robots, like the ones here in the picture behind me. I get to play with robots and use robots to map the gaps in our maps around the world. And that takes us everywhere from beaches all the way out to the edge of the continental shelf. And we're always looking for new opportunities and ways to apply mapping technology. That means platforms like robotic platforms and the sensors into new realms and areas. And that was what was really exciting about this project when Kate first came to sit down with me and talk about this issue, which I only knew a little bit about. You know, the fact that we occasionally will run into, we'll see in our sonar, you know, targets that we weren't quite sure of. And, you know, one thing I want to mention is we often think of the deep ocean. This is something I'm often having to stress to my students is, we often think of the deep ocean as a difficult place to work, and it certainly is. But it turns out, ironically, that very shallow coastal waters are also very challenging places to work. The turbidity, meaning the sort of cloudiness in the water, means that most of our coastal waterways are opaque to optical remote sensing, and water is really great at absorbing radio waves. So it turns out that we quite literally use sound to see. Using sound is really one of our primary ways that we explore and understand and communicate underwater. And one of those major tools that we use in this work is called side scan sonar. Now, sonar is an acronym that means sound, navigation, and ranging. It's the same approach that dolphins and bats use for sort of echolocation. But scientists and engineers have developed systems that allow us to put pulses of high frequency sound waves into the water column. And I'm showing you an example here in this image in the upper left is showing you a side scan sonar waterfall, and it's looking off to either side. And the analogy would be, imagine that you're trying to explore around your house at night with just a pair of flashlights. And what is really exciting about this particular time that we're living in, from the standpoint of mapping, there's a whole host of reasons why we're living in perhaps too exciting of a time, is that we have these amazing consumer electronics that are putting into the hands of recreational boaters and fishers technologies that only a handful of years ago were only the domain of very advanced research labs and offshore companies. And so as my student Hunter is in this picture in the upper right is pointing at a screen from a consumer grade sonar system. And that's what we have been utilizing as our primary tool in this project. And that's not because we don't have a whole host of very expensive sophisticated sonars that we normally work with, but we realized there was an opportunity here to try to address this recreational problem with some recreational technologies, which potentially opens up the prospect for us to engage other, you know, community scientists, you know, folks that could otherwise come out and help us do this mapping work. And so that's what we're using primarily in this project. If we go to the next slide then here. Once we have these sonar devices, it's more than just having them and turning them on, but we need to carefully plan out and execute a survey mission, which requires us to mow the lawn. And mowing the lawn is, just as it sounds and just as it is for you and your own homes and yards, is pacing back and forth slowly, methodically over the water surface and putting out these acoustic sound pulses and acoustically painting the seafloor. And we want to be careful not to miss any spots because we don't want to miss any of the ghost pots that might be there. And by running this survey methodology slowly and carefully, then we can bring that data back into the lab and we can generate mosaics like you're seeing here, which allow us to basically reveal the seabed and what it would look like, almost as if we had drained the water from the inland bay. This is a portion of the inland bay known as Nude Cove, just behind Dewey Beach. And here you can see what side scan sonar gives you is sort of a tonal imagery of the texture and geometry of the seabed. And by that, I mean, the areas here in this particular color palette that are lighter, brighter bronze colors, those are areas associated with a little coarser sediment. So they're gonna be more sandy areas. Whereas those darker blotches and blotchy areas are areas of mud. And what it immediately reveals to us is that this is a very complex area. For many years, we used to think that the seafloor was just homogeneous, you know, infinite amounts of sand. And the more and more mapping we do, the more we realize that it's very complex and composed of varying seabed types. And we could go through our sonar data and very carefully pull out and start to recognize those targets. These little nice, they're really a great sonar target to see in these crab pots, because the acoustic sound really resonates and rings as it interacts with them. And so we started going through, and as we started reviewing the data, our jaws just started to drop, because we found that we almost couldn't keep up with the amount of clicking. Just this one area of Bay Cove, we found more than 370, we found a total of 373 of these ghost pots in an area of about 178 acres. And that works out to more than 2 pots per acre on average. If we go to the next slide, we also explored a little bit of Love Creek. And again, we almost everywhere we went, we started, you know, finding pots. In total, in about a kilometer squared we've mapped, we found 561 pots. That puts these densities on the high end of any that have been even reported in places in the Chesapeake Bay. And so that told us that we really had, you know, we had a challenge and problem on our hand. And bear in mind, we've looked at only a few hundred acres. The inland bays are about 20,000 acres all told. So there's still quite a bit of work out there to do. And now, once we had done our mapping and found these targets, we used those to form the basis of a removal effort, which I'll hand it over to Kate and she'll tell you about.
Right, so last winter in January, we piloted a removal effort. Now that we had this more comprehensive surveying completed by Art's team, and so we piloted this effort with the assistance of partners from DENREC, so Delaware Coastal Programs, Delaware Fish and Wildlife, and then we had volunteers from University of Delaware, as well as Sea Grant joining us and Arts Lab. And the removal effort was first primarily to simply remove the threat of these ghost pots from these areas that have been surveyed. But we also wanted to collect local information to kind of bring some relevancy to our area, to understand, knowing that this is a ubiquitous issue where we have blue crab fisheries, we really want to be able to kind of tell the story about what's happening here in our own backyard. So we're documenting the species that are impacted, as well as the condition of the pots. Are these pots still ghost fishing, or have they degraded so much that they're no longer an issue? And then a very important factor of this removal effort, this pilot project, was to test our removal methods with the goal of being able to kind of figure out the logistics and the methods so that we could expand this project now to use volunteers that are interested in helping us out on the water, primarily to help with hauling these pots. And so what we were doing in particular with that goal in mind was actually using that sonar to relocate these pots on the removal days. We tested the process of marking these pots with clips and lines and buoys so that we could then come up and reapproach that pot from a boat that did not have sonar installed. And that worked really well and is kind of the basis of what we're hoping to do moving forward. This year, in fact, we have been awarded funds to be able to continue on in expanding these removal efforts out. So last year with this comprehensive surveys and follow-up pilot project, we managed to remove 99 lost pots in 2 days with really about 3 boats working to remove these pots. We had a few folks moving in and out, but primarily had about three boats pulling and managed to pull out just about 100 in just 2 days. Oh, just over half of those pots were still ghost fishing, which is good to know. So some of the pots had been degraded, but others, over half of them were still ghost fishing. And about half of those pots that were still ghost fishing did not have those bycatch reduction devices present on them. So that gives us a sense of how risky they are for these diamondback terrapins. And the species, we did find diamondback terrapins inside these pots. So we found live and dead blue crabs, live and dead oyster toadfish, live and dead diamondback terrapins. Some of these other species were likely using the pots as habitat. But a key kind of piece of information to convey is that when we're talking about these species we find in the pots, it's not showing the full breadth of the impact that pot has had over its lifetime in the water, because these animals eat each other and because they degrade. So case in point, these are the only remains of diamondback terrapins, so evidence that terrapins had been captured in the pots. These are scutes from terrapins that Art is looking at in this photo. I'm sorry, over here. I had my cursor on the wrong screen.
Great, thanks, Kate. One of the things we're continuing to do in this program is constantly looking for new ways to innovate in the mapping domain, because it like I said, it's a challenging place to work. But there have been some exciting new developments just in the last few years in consumer sonar systems, not just the ability to do the broad area lawn mowing that I mentioned, but now there are consumer grade sonar systems that can give you a live video image of the seabed, like the Garmin LiveScope or the Hummingbird 360, that can give you a photo of the seabed in a 360 view, and we're experimenting with these technologies to help us in that on the recovery effort, because we want that to be as efficient as we can, because we want to try to recover as many of these as derelict pots that are otherwise just trashing the seabed as we can. In addition to the exciting things happening in platforms with robots and the sonar systems, there are some exciting developments going on in data science, particularly using machine learning. So we've been partnering with some companies to develop AI techniques to go through our sonar and find these pots, because there's literally hundreds of them, and we want to make sure we don't miss any. And so working on this has a real positive upside for us. We really enjoy being part of this effort to better the conditions in the bay. And it's also forced us to sort of, it challenged us in ways to improve some of our data analysis and acquisition methodologies.
So moving forward, as I mentioned, we're looking to expand our removal efforts. We're planning to do that this winter with the assistance of volunteers. We have some additional research questions as this project supports a graduate student. And we have some off-season monitoring that we're going to conduct as part of this project. And then, of course, outreach and education. So kind of trying to get the word out to crabbers about things that they can do to help try and minimize the potential to lose their pots in the first place. But we are looking forward right now to planning a removal effort this winter, in particular targeting volunteers that have their own boats that could come out and help us in the middle of winter, getting pretty dirty and helping us with some of that labor. So I'll have some contact information on our final slide if that sounds like you. And I just wanted to take a moment to acknowledge all of the different groups that helped us out this year. This is not something we can do on our own, but it truly takes a village. So with that, here's my contact information if anyone's interested in contacting me to help out with the effort this year, and hopefully we have a little time for questions.
Great, thank you so much, Art and Kate. We do have a couple questions coming in. The first one is, what models do other states use for the removal of crab pots? Who funds their removal, and who actually does the removal work in states that have established programs?
That's such a great question. There's not one single model for states, but a lot of times commercial watermen are leveraged to help out. Oftentimes they think that's because they have the technical skill to help out. Sometimes these pots are a lot, like Delaware Bay is a really deep dynamic environment, challenging to work in, whereas the inland bays is protected and shallow. So there's the opportunity to maybe leverage the assistance of folks that don't have that same level of technical skill needed in these other environments, but also because they're oftentimes, I think the finger gets pointed to the commercial side. And then there's all sorts of different funding mechanisms. Sometimes nonprofits host these cleanups. Sometimes the states do it. Sometimes there's like down in Louisiana, they were interested in obtaining a sustainable seafood certification. And so there was a lot of state support to fund that work down there as part of the commercial fishery, as an example.
Great. So a couple other questions. Are there any publicly available maps that would allow people to do magnet fishing to help retrieve ghost pots? And would magnet fishing be a viable alternative to the removal approach that you described?
Do you have some opinions? Or do you need to take it?
Sure. Well, I mean, I guess in answer to the first question, I think we'd be happy to try to, we've actually been in discussions with DENREC about ways to try to help make the maps that we produce available to folks, particularly so you can see areas that are muddy versus sandier. One of the things, though, that is particularly challenging about shallow coastal mapping is that, and this is true anywhere, every seafloor map has a use-by date, and it varies the more dynamic a system is. And when we've gone back, to the same places, we've seen some changes where areas that had sand eroded away and exposed mud. I'm not very familiar with the magnet fishing technique, but I can say that these pots are very difficult at times, particularly the ones that settle down into muddier substrates are very difficult to recover. And we're trying to recover them with the hope that maybe some of them can be reused. So you want to take care that you don't injure yourself and that you don't tear the pots apart needlessly. But they can be very difficult to recover, even using grapples, and it's a pretty arduous hard work effort.
Great. And one last question: what do you do with the pots once they've been removed?
Oh, so we a number of things. So a lot of them aren't in great condition and they go to a scrap metal dumpster. But the ones that are in better condition, we are retaining a number to do outreach and education. So we had some plans this year at fairs and festivals with some of our recovered, refurbished pots that we'll have to hopefully be able to do after we get on the other side of COVID-19. But we've also been working with the Partnership for Delaware Estuary. It's a nonprofit group based in northern part of Delaware, and they're really interested in using these pots in their living shoreline projects, so using them as substrate. So we've already got plans for this year's removal effort to transfer up to 100 of those pots to that organization to use in living shoreline projects, which is really exciting.
Great. Well, thank you so much again, Kate and Art. We really appreciate you sharing some of these results. This is a fascinating project, so thank you. A quick note to the audience, you'll see a poll appear shortly with a brief question to help us gauge your response to this session. The next session in this track, which is the investigation track, is titled Tending the Largest Living Shoreline in New England, and will begin momentarily. The next session in the exploration track is a follow-along at home art and science activity focused on making a marine science collage. Just an additional reminder, in addition to these live sessions, there's an abundance of pre-recorded material and interactive activities on our Coast Day website. So please visit the site as well. And thank you again for participating.